I think with all that has gone on today, I thank everyone who's been a part of the program. I thank everyone who has thanked Sister Tracy for reading the scripture, and she loves reading the scripture. Thank her. And I just want you to know that God has still got a message today. Amen. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you again just for what you are about to do. We thank you, Father God, that we carry on anyhow in the midst of some disappointments. So, Father God, I thank you for the choir today. I thank you for the word of prayer that came from Brother Cheryl. I thank you, Lord God, for the message to the youth that came from Sister Pam. So, Father God, in the name of Jesus, please just stop by here. Lord God, let somebody touch somebody, let them cry out and say, Lord God, I thank you for all that you have done for me. Now, Lord God, let us examine ourselves as this word goes out to your people, Lord God. And Lord God, whatever you do, you always do in decency and in order. In Jesus' name, amen. If I could choose for a theme for a few moments, it would be committed or involved. Committed or involved. You know, Brother Chuck, I have begun to realize that many churches today think they are committed when in actuality they are only involved. Brother Cheryl, there is a big difference between those two words. I am a big breakfast person. I can eat breakfast morning, afternoon, or late evening. I like a traditional breakfast, nothing fancy, eggs, ham, bacon, potatoes, and pancakes. When you consider, that's not much. And Scrabble too, look at somebody saying Scrabble too. When you consider the eggs and the ham, there is a big difference on how each made it to your plate. The chicken simply laid the eggs. Whether scrambled, over easy, sunny side up, omelets, it was only involved. End of the day, when you go back to the chicken coop to get your eggs, the chickens are still alive. Do I have a witness now? But the pig, however, come on somebody, help me preach. Makes no difference if it's ham or bacon or sausage, he had to give up his life. Do I have a witness now? The pig was committed. Help me somebody. Life is filled with choices. We must choose when to go to bed and when to get up. Help me somebody. We must choose what to eat and what not to eat. We must choose what to wear and what not to wear. We choose what to do with our time. Help me somebody. We choose where we'll go to work and where we'll go out to eat at night. Life is filled with choices. Some choices are easy to make, other choices are more difficult to make. We all who we are today, Brother Cheryl, because of the choices we made yesterday. The choices that we make today have an impact on the decisions we will be making on tomorrow.
That's right.
They establish a pattern and a foundation for our life, but some may say, but Pastor, I haven't always made the right choices. Help me somebody. You and I may never be able to undo the choices we made on yesterday, but I just stopped by to tell somebody there is good news that's on the way. He who holds our tomorrow is able to turn it around for us. Now, you know, today I want to focus on only one right choice that we can make. In our text, we find Joshua presenting what we call his farewell address. From the first mentioning of Joshua, we are given the picture of an honorable man. One you would want to take home to mama. Help me somebody. In his early years, he is sent as a representative of Ephraim to spy out the land of Canaan. He and Caleb seem to be from a different stand than the other spies. The exciting voice speaking with optimism, is about their ability to take the land. He said, let's do it. He said, we can take it. He said, like a bunch of mountaineers looking at a fit pack of Wolverines saying, we can take them. Help me somebody. But what was it that caused this nation to follow such a leader? Was it faith? Was it youthful military exuberance? Who can tell? But this type of leader Israel needed as they awaited the new campaign of crossing the river. Can we take a quick snapshot or a brief review of his life? Joshua is now quite old.
No, that's right.
And he has seen a lot in his lifetime. His early formative years were spent in service to the great liberator Moses. His later years were spent leading God's people into battle in the promised land. He has seen the plagues of Egypt. He has seen the parting of the Red Sea. Help me somebody. He has endured the trip through the desert to the edge of the promised land and then the trip back in the desert for 40 years of wilderness wandering. Come on somebody. He saw God part the Jordan River. Oh my Lord. He saw God crumble the walls of Jericho and send the enemies into panic. Yeah. He also saw the punishment of Achan after his sin. Yeah. He then saw the restoration of the blessing and presence of God, and now he is still quite old.
Yeah.
He has led a full life, and he has been strong and courageous as God commanded. He has seen the scars from 100 battles. Help me somebody. He has known the power and presence of God in his life and in his leadership. And now, look at somebody say now. And now he recognizes his death is near. And Joshua's last days is where we find ourselves today in this 24th chapter. Sister Mamie, I imagine the Israelites began to wonder what is it that they would be able to say after those days. What would be recorded in the pages of history? They understood after all these years, their campaign was now coming to a close. And a leader is leaving his parting words on his people. Joshua's life is coming to an end. Look at somebody say he was committed. There is a transition in the making from a people consumed by getting the other people out of the land to being a people in the land. So Joshua asked the nation, who will serve now that you are not all focused on conquest? Will you return to the gods you used to worship? Or will you serve Yahweh? Do I have a witness now?
Yep.
There's a back and forth thing that's going on now between Joshua, the elders, the heads, and the judges. I'm telling a story now. They are gathered at the same place where they finally captured people in Shechem. Joshua calls his people together for another covenant invitation. The first verse read in preparation of this sermon really caught my attention. Joshua called for the leaders of God's people. Where they were supposed to be. We should know where the leaders of the church are located. They should always be on their post. Joshua knew, if no one else was around, that the leaders were always on their post. Anybody on my street now? Leaders of this time were committed. Leaders cannot lead if you are not on your post.
That's right.
Amen.
Got mighty quiet for me here.
Yeah, that's right.
That's all right. Keep going.
Can't lead if you cannot be found.
Yeah.
I need you to lead during life seminar. I feel like preaching now. I need you to lead during worship and on Wednesday nights for Bible study. I need you to lead during Wednesday prayer service. Do I have a witness now? I need you to lead if if we're in here on Saturday, official board. I need you to lead during worships and seminars. Help me, somebody. Leaders should be out front and not in the back. Help me, somebody.
That's right.
Joshua, before addressing the nation of Israel, called on and challenged the leaders first. He challenged them to be more than involved, but to be committed. Look at somebody and say, there's a difference between being committed and being involved. Come on, somebody. The only reason why some of you are committed to your job is because you get paid for it. Do I have a witness now? Anybody on my street right now? The only reason that you are committed to your job is because you're getting paid for it. Let the truth be told, some of you don't even like your jobs. Do I have a witness right now? But you've got to understand there is a difference between being committed and being passionate about something than just becoming involved in it. Do I have a witness right now? You've got to understand this calling that coming to church every Sunday, coming to Bible study or other things of the church should be a commitment that you embrace. Yes. The reason why folks don't come is because they're only on the involved level.
Praise God.
Can I preach this thing? If you put that kind of commitment that you do on your job in the church,
oh, y'all don't hear me.
Then we wouldn't have the kind of stuff that we have going on inside the church. If you are passionate about something,
come on.
You will knock down walls. You'll go through things. You'll go through ups and downs. You'll go through valleys. And you will still love God anyhow for what he has done for you. Anybody on my street right now understand what I'm saying? We need some committed folk, not involved folk, but committed folk who will stand there even though things may be going wrong.
That's right.
You are faithful.
Thank you, Jesus.
To those things.
Thank you, God.
That you are committed to. This applies to all areas of our lives. Anyone ever try to lose weight? If we are not committed to lose weight, we will not be faithful in the process. We go to the gym and work out for 1 week, even though you're paying the gym fee. Anybody on my street right now, I see a whole lot of heads nodding. Some of you have gotten to the gym that you paid for last year only 3 or 4 times. But you've got to understand that if you are passionate about something, if you are passionate about losing weight, then the results will happen. You got to be committed to lose weight. Anybody ever try to do it? Come on, somebody. And it's still not working. Help me, somebody. Ever start school or college and you got tired of it? Anybody with me now? If we are not committed to the process, we will not be faithful in going to class or studying. Ever been married?
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mean that.
That's all
right. I'm going to leave that alone. I better leave that alone since I'm divorced. Help me, somebody. Do I have a witness here? The mood is different than it was at the beginning of the Old Testament book. When God's people were wandering in the wilderness, fighting and defending their nation. Gone are the days of Sinai wandering. Gone are the days of anxiously waiting across the river. Gone are the days of marching around Jericho and trying to right the ship. Gone are the days of tribal land and distribution. Joshua reviews the conquest campaign, as well as a history lesson in God being good to God's covenant agreement. Amen. And concludes with a personal statement in regards to his family fidelity. He does not say, as for me and my people. Rather, he states, Jerome, as for me and my family, we will serve the Lord. It appears Israel was fit for a battle campaign. But now the question is, are they fit for settling in the land and trusting God in a new way campaign? Unfortunately, isn't that most of us that we can say? In spite of what you decide to do, in spite of your commitment level, in spite of what you want to do with your time, in spite of how you feel about supporting the church, me and my family will serve the Lord. Help me, somebody. There are days, y'all don't have to take my time. We definitely really, really early. There are days of looking ahead and deciding what kind of people we will be in the land. But with possession of the promised land comes great responsibility. When you get to be a leader in the church, when you own a choir, when you are part of some organization in the church, that is a commitment to follow that thing out. Do I have a witness right now? We've got to stop bailing out when you're getting mad at somebody. We've got to stop bailing out when you know that you can't get your way. I just stopped by to tell somebody else that if we work together in God and be committed to the cause, God will bless the organization and God will bless the church.
That's right.
My Lord, you cannot preach this thing.
It now, when you sign on, look at somebody say sign on. When you sign on, when you tell the leader of the dance ministry that I'm going to dance, then you need to dance. If you agree to be part of the steward board, then you should be stewarding. Help me, somebody. You've got to understand that your word is what everybody goes on. Do I have a witness now? I'm preaching to myself also. But you've got to understand this morning that it's all about God, because he committed to you. He sent his only son to die for you. So therefore, when you sign on that line,
amen.
That's right.
You've got to carry out that responsibility. Look at somebody saying that I got to carry it out. I'm getting tired of folk who sign on to something, and because it's not their way, that they stop doing it.
That's right.
Do I have a witness now?
Right.
And they get on the phone, Sister Wilson, and tell everybody how they feel about it. And all of a sudden, you've got people talking about it across the land. Do I have a witness right now? And everybody is mad at somebody. I sympathize with you. But you've got to understand that you're going to have a mind on your own in Jesus' name. Knowing that once you sign up to be on something, that you're going to be committed to what you signed up for. Yeah. Look at somebody and say, are you committed or are you involved? It now becomes your duty to take what you have secured and pass it along to the next generation. What kind, Brother Ernie, what kind of an example are we setting when we're always bailing out of stuff? Do we have a witness here? And what kind of an example are our children taking with them? If mommy and daddy can bail out, help me somebody. If my aunt and uncle can bail out, then I'm going to bail out too. Do I have a witness right now? You've got to understand that our young people are looking at us to see what we do. And then we yell at them when they don't do the right thing.
I didn't mean to say all of that.
That's
all right. Joshua is wondering whether or not the people are up to the religious task as much as they were in military and in the political field. Don't get me wrong, I know there are plenty more battles to be fought, but as far as Joshua goes, his battle days are coming to an end. After all the battles, the slaughter, the delivery of the land, the only thing Joshua can have control is he and his family. He looks at his people, Brother Cheryl, and challenges their ability to be faithful to God. Look at somebody and say, it's all about being faithful to God.
It's about being faithful.
Like they were faithful to him in battle. I am sure the compiler of this conquest narrative lived in the aftermath of these days, in the time of Judges, when the people of God were all too quick to forget their contract. Look at somebody say, I got a contract. When you get here, when you give your life to Christ, when you turn over everything to Him, you signed a contract. Come on, somebody. That means that all that goes on inside of this book that you're going to try to do. Notice I said you're going to try to do. But some of you forget your contract. This is a lifetime contract.
Amen.
Because He said once you give your life to Christ, that no one can pluck you from the hand of God. So therefore, you already have a contract. Now, whether you live up to that contract is up to who?
Yourself.
That's right. That's right.
I want all of you to think about how you have fulfilled your contract. You have made mistakes. I know we all have. But right now, I need some committed folk to give their committed time to serving God and loving God and doing the work that He has put on you. I can get anybody to be involved. But keep in mind, being committed means that I come to church in spite of I don't have no money in my pocket. I come church, if by the fact I may lose my house, I come to church when everybody else is laying in bed in my house. I come to church to give God praise because He brought me from a mighty long ways. Yeah. Being committed means that nobody's going to hurt my feelings. Come on, somebody, help me preach.
That's right.
Being committed means, Ernie, that I'm going to do everything that I can do to uplift Oak Street and also to glorify God. Everything that I say that comes out of my mouth is going to be positive because I want God to bless the house.
Yeah, yeah.
That's it.
All about helping you.
Oh, I made it, nobody.
I'm almost done.
Take your time.
There he is. A responsibility. Don't you realize that there is a reward at the end for those who are what?
Committed.
There's a gift, Chuck. There's a gift that's going to come your way if you remain faithful to God. I know there's going to be some trying times. I know you're going to be to challenge whatever need inside. But if you stay with the program, help me, Sister Pam, if you stay with the program, God will bless you in the end. You can't get your master's without staying to the end. You can't get your BS degree or your doctorate without staying to the end. And don't you realize how good God has been to you, kept you through that stuff? Somebody got to say, thank you, Lord. I want you to notice the standard of service Joshua demands. He says, work with all faithfulness.
Oh.
He didn't say with half faithfulness.
Oh.
He said, work with all. Everybody say all.
Oh.
He said, with all faithfulness.
Oh.
He doesn't leave room for casual faith. Oh, I said something. Casual faith can't cut it.
Uh-huh.
Anybody with me now? If you want to be casual, do it on your own time. But when you come in the house, the standard is with all faithfulness. That means, you know, whatever happens in your life, whatever happens on your job, it's with what? With all faithfulness. Every day is not going to be a good day.
That's right.
Come on, but you get through it because of the faith that you have in God. Anybody with me? Can somebody wave their hand in the air and say, it's with all faith? All faithfulness. That's what it's all about. Why do you think that you're still alive? Because He was faithful to you. So therefore, you got to be what? Faithful to Him.
Teaching.
He doesn't leave room, Cheryl.
That's right.
For casual faith. For serving God when it's convenient. Oh, when things are going well. Oh, when life is easy. He doesn't leave room, Chuck, for doing faith on our terms. He calls us to serve with all faithfulness. What if no reward.
Woo, Jesus.
Somebody help me. What if there was no appreciation? What if there is no pat on the back along the way? What if you find nothing but opposition? Anybody feel me now?
Oh yeah.
Joshua says, serve the Lord what with all faithfulness. Let's be honest, that is not easy sometimes. But if you hold on to the prize, see, because he's going to give you a reward in the end. And occasionally, Sister Pam, he'll pat you on the back. He'll show you a miracle. Do I have a witness now? He'll give you something that you can hold on to in order to realize that he's still God. How many of you have had a miracle in your life and God has blessed you? Somebody put their hands up in the air. Do I have a witness now? You better serve God with gladness for all that he's done for you. How many of you should be today? Do I have a witness right now? Somebody better cry. Mention the record of choice and unlimited. It's always been life or death. See, that's what you gotta understand. It's either life or it's either death. Blessings or curses. Come on, somebody. Adam and Eve chose death. Ananias and Sapphira chose death. The rich young ruler chose death. Help me, somebody. King Agrippa, who said that you almost persuaded me to become a Christian. Help me, somebody. He chose death. Pontius Pilate, who had it right in front of him. His wife told him, help me, come on, somebody, help me preach. His wife told him, you better leave that man alone. But you know what? He liked his status more than doing the right thing. Do I have a witness now? That's what's wrong in the church. Some of us like our status more than we love people than we love God. If this is the only success that you have in your life, being a steward or a trustee or something else, then you are lost ball in high weeds. Do I have a witness right now? I just stopped by to tell somebody this morning. That that's an old saying that my father used to say. But you've got to understand, it's either life or death. I feel my help coming now. It's either life or death or blessings or cursings. You better be thankful this morning that God has brought you from somewhere. Somebody better say yeah. I don't know about you this morning, but I'm so glad. I'm choosing life. Anybody on my street right now, you got to choose life. Death. Abraham and Lazarus chose life. Paul chose life. Peter chose life. Philip told Nathaniel they had found him and if he doubted to come and see. Thank you, Lord. I don't know about you today. I'm tired of folk choosing death. God gave you everything that you have. And yet, all you're giving him is casual faith. I'm tired of the sign on the marquee reading casual faith. No, I just made that up. I don't know about you, but if you were ever in the army or some of the military, you couldn't have casual service. Come on, somebody. I never was in the military, but my dad used to tell me he was in the Korean War that there's a certain time to get up and a certain time to go to bed and certain things to wear and certain things not to wear. You must have your hair cut and hair off your face. Help me, somebody. And I don't know about you, but if I'm ever in a foxhole, I want the man that's behind me to have my back. Do I have a witness? is here. I don't feel that we have that in our churches. You better watch your back, because somebody might throw something at you. Do we have a witness here? Anybody want to speak right now? I'm being blatantly honest today. You got to understand that if you are committed, even though that you may not like somebody's ways, that you still love them in Jesus' name. Do I have a witness now? I didn't say in your name, but I said it in whose name? In Jesus' name. So stop worrying about stuff, because you got to understand it's all about serving God. Doesn't matter whether they like you or not. Doesn't matter about anything. But as long as you can say that I did my best, and God will bless me. I did my best, no matter what. I did my best, because He's gonna say, "Oh, thank you for what you have done. I will make you now rule over many things." Stop worrying about folk, but pray for them in Jesus' name. Committed? Mm-hmm. Well, no. Involved people fall off. Committed folk hang on there.
That's right.
Amen. Don't you realize that God prepares you every day to hang in there?
Amen.
You know? How many of you ever raised kids? I ain't gonna talk about it now, but they're in the building. But you hung in there.
That's right.
And you didn't like what they did. But you did what? You hung in there. And you had several talks with your young people. Anybody know what I'm saying? And you talked to them with green and blue in the face. Do I have a witness now? And sometimes things still didn't work. It took my daughter, she got to 25 years old, for me to see what she's doing right now. Do I have a witness right now? But you got to understand, you got to hang in there. And if you have a family, you got to be committed to your children. Help me somebody. And also, even though that your marriage may not be going on right, help me somebody. Sometimes that you got to stand there and see what happens. Do I have a witness now? I'm preaching to myself. Help me somebody. But all you got to realize is that you got to be committed. Look at somebody and say committed. Stop having that casual faith. I'm tired of casual faith. I'll pick it up when I feel like picking it up. Committed or involved. Read that full chapter. That's a great chapter, the 24th chapter of Joshua. And you know, he stood there. He stayed the course. Even though that he didn't know where he was going. Abraham was the same way. God said, pick up your family.
And go.
Take your crazy cousin Lot. What? Lord, you tell me to take my crazy cousin? I've seen what he did. Now, Lord, you gotta be lying to me. He said, no, go. Stop by 123. Save him lane. 123, save him lane. And pick him up. Don't take nothing with you. Now, it took a committed spirit. Lord, come on somebody. Think about it, sister. Mm-hmm. God says, give up your apartment. Mm-hmm. Sell your furniture. Mm-hmm. Kiss your babies. Mm-hmm. And go. But along the way, pick up your crazy cousin, Susie. Come on, somebody. And then you say, Lord, what you want me to do? Let me hear you again. Sell your furniture. Kiss your babies. Quit your job. Stop by and get crazy, Susie. Wow. Look at somebody and say, that's real commitment.
That's real commitment.
Because I don't even like crazy Susie. Help me somebody. Oh, she got the car. Okay, that's all right. Amen. Let church say amen. Let us stand over the church, my Lord. That you would say amen. What I want you to do today is to reflect on your level of service. that we can't be in this thing if you're not committed. The auxiliaries won't work. The boards won't work. The witnessing to folk on the street won't work. I didn't say you should be committed to Shepherd Crack, no. I'll get your way down the crowns here, help me somebody. But all I'm saying is that you gotta be committed to this call. All of you have a calling. How do you think that you got here? How do you think that you got here? One day he told you, one day he called you and said, hey, look, you hear what he said? I stand at the door and knock. If you allow me to come in, I'll come and sup with you and you're with me. Come on, somebody. I need committed people. People who go through thick and thin. People who go through the enemy and say, I love you in spite of them. That's what you need. All people ain't gonna like you. If the truth be told sometimes that your mama didn't like you either. And your father didn't like you. Help me somebody. I know I'm racist. Because sometimes my mother got tired of me. Help me somebody. She said, go out the door and leave me alone. Anybody ever been there? Think about it. If you don't have to say on a scale from 1 to 10, where are you?
That's right.
I'm not gonna say that right now. But I want you to think about where you are. Are you holding up your church? Are you holding up the arms of the people in your church? If you're part of the student board, trustee board, missionary society, everything, usher board, everything, how committed are you? And I ask you that question, you gotta answer. Pastor's aid, things like that. How committed are you? Quiet. How committed are you? We shouldn't have people staying home. I don't feel like going today. But didn't God take you through 6 days? And you can't give him. We've only been in church for an hour and a half. Right now we're 11:30. And yet he gives you how many hours a day? 24 hours a day? Come on. And you said 7 days a week and you can't give him 90 minutes. Woke you up this morning, sent the angel down for you. Made sure that you got the work safe and got back. Paying flies a lot. Got the plane up, got the plane down. Did not disappear like that one plane did. Let me somebody. Come on, you ought to thank God. You ought to thank God for it. That's what he did. And they still haven't found the plane. You are a blessed people. Look at somebody and say, I am blessed. You are a blessed people.
I am blessed.
Amen. I'm not going to assume that everyone will be saved in the house. But I really want you to think about this sermon today. Committed or involved. Involved people are not connected. Look at somebody and say, they are not connected.
They are involved.
That's all they are. But being committed means I'm going to give everything. I'm going to sell out. Look at somebody and say, sell out. Involved people are on slippery ground. They'll fall. But committed people also fall, but they get back up.
Amen.
Amen. Is there somebody here today who has not ever given their life to Christ? If you have never given your life to Christ, you have publicly said it, please come up to the altar now and say, Lord, I thank you for standing at the door and knocking for me. And now, today, March 23rd, I'm going to give my life to Christ. I'm going to say, Lord, this is it. Thank you for just having me. Thank you for being there for me. Is there one today? Is there one today? Is there one today? Second call, maybe somebody wants to rededicate. Say, Lord, strengthen my commitment. The altar's open. Lord, strengthen my commitment. Take the obstacles out of my way that get me not to come to church. Is there one today who wants to come up and Jesus and say, Lord, strengthen me because I know that I can do it. I know I can do better. Is there one today? Third call, all is open for prayer. Somebody needs prayer. Come on up right now. Come on up if you need prayer. My Lord, truly God is able. Come up and have prayer. Come up and have prayer.
John.
Yes.
Steve. Right, thank you.